third day. So today, George is going to continue his tutorial on dynamical systems and learning in games.
Thank you, Vasily. Okay. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the second part of dynamical systems and learning in games. Right, so so actually there's been a slight change in the structure, I guess, of the tutorial. So I decided like to put between between going to the description of the results about learning in zero-sum games and learning potential games, a short interlude about dynamical systems, some ideas and solution concepts that somehow emerge from that literature. I want to start today our discussion by examining the meaning of the word equilibrium. In game theory, many times we just take it as an absolute given that this solution is something we understand like very, very well. And I want to try to actually give focus some attention to some issues that might not be immediately clear. So of course, game theory has its roots embedded in dynamical systems theory. Everything comes effectively derived from Brouwer fixed point theorem, which is a theory about topology of dynamical systems. Okay. However, over the history of the evolution of the two fields, game theory and dynamical systems, the way these two disciplines use the word equilibrium is becoming increasingly distinct. Okay. These ideas are becoming somewhat divergent. So in equilibrium theory, in game theory, equilibrium is used to mean in a somewhat colloquial sense that this is like a stable state. So somehow you're there, this is something that there's some stability notion over there, right? We use this phrase very, very often, almost like automatically, right? Whereas in dynamical systems, equilibrium means stationarity. Okay. And I want to start by pointing out something that might not be immediately clear, but I want to try to focus on this, is that stationarity and stability, they're both very interesting, very useful, and very, very, very important ideas, but they're also totally orthogonal to each other. Okay. And what do I mean by orthogonal? So here's, for example, this is like a triangle. So think of this, or as a cone, and this is a physical equilibrium in physical space. Okay. And what we mean by equilibrium, what do we mean here by stability? Okay. So is it if I push it and I remove this minor perturbation, then this triangle will get back to where it started from. Okay. That's what stability means. But of course, you have a different kind of equilibrium. For now, this equilibrium is flipped. Okay. Now, if you perturb it a little bit, then it sort of totally diverges from its position and then just falls off, goes to another state, right? So you see that an equilibrium can be both stable and unstable, again. But also, here's on the other side, we have a dynamical system. So here's think of some particle moving along this cycle, okay? And in one dynamical system, a minor perturbation of this position of the particle, there's a movement that's sort of like self-enforced the cycle. So you will return back the cycle from you started from. Okay. So that limit cycle is stable. Right. So this is an attractor. So whereas if you look at the other behavior right here, you see another kind of cycle, but this one now is unstable, right? Like an infinitesimal perturbation of the position of this particle would actually move it away, okay, to some totally different behavior, right? So and this is exactly what I want to point out here, is that look, equilibrium can be both stable and unstable, okay, right? So and then you can have totally different notions which are both stable and unstable, okay? So these four different quadrants really means that these two notions are independent, they're orthogonal, right? To each other. All right, so let's try to push this a little bit more to even look at this at the dictionary definition of equilibrium versus stability, right? So according to the Merriam-Webster dictionary, Equilibrium is a state in which opposing forces or actions are balanced. Okay, a state which is balanced. So it could be upside down triangle. Okay, and if you leave it over there, it's balanced at the moment. Okay, but a critical observation is that stability, the word stability or stable, is not part of an equilibrium concept, even in plain English. Okay, that's not, an equilibrium is not a stable state. Okay, if you look at again the dictionary definition of stability, stability according to the dictionary is the property of a body that causes it, when disturbed from a condition of equilibrium or steady motion, so either fixed point or like a limit cycle, right, to develop forces or moments that restore the original condition. Okay, so that's what stability means. And the critical observation here is that stability can only be defined through disturbances. Okay, so in the notion of disturbance is not there at Nash equilibrium or game theoretical solution concepts, at least a priori. Okay, all right, so what I want to point out is that, okay, this ubiquitous connection between Nash or different notions of equilibria and stability in game theory is largely an unwarranted linguistic debt. Okay, we just do it automatically, we just use these words. Okay, but these words here, actually we make an implicit commitment. We say that, like, oh, you know, these points actually have to be, or they ought to be stable, they ought to be attracting. Okay, but this property is not there. It's something we enforce on this concept artificially. Okay, and so it's not in the mathematics, it's just something added upon on top of it. Okay, and I claim that, like, this is a source of a lot of trouble and confusion. Okay, so now I'm not saying that, like, Nash equilibria is something we should not study. No, like, Nash equilibria and many different types of equilibria are extremely interesting, informative, worthwhile of study, and so on and so forth. Like, we're really doing a lot of great work studying them. Okay, but for reasons that have little to do with stability. Okay, and to actually, you know, help you understand this concept a little bit more, is I will describe equilibrium as a special case of a totally different class of behaviors. Okay, so as I said, equilibrium is a special and in fact an extremal case of a totally different class of behaviors, and this class of behaviors from dynamical systems is known as recurrence. Okay. All right, so we know what's the next point of view, the next point in the agenda. Let's go back to the dictionary. Okay, what does recurrence mean? Okay, recurrence is a repeated occurrence, like a déjà vu, something that happens over and over again. Right, a new occurrence of something that happened or appeared before. Right, and now it's clear that Nash equilibrium or any notion of equilibrium is an actually extreme notion of recurrence. Okay, if nothing changes, the same thing is again and again and again there all the time. Okay, all right. So in that sense, somehow it's the most powerful or the most, you know, restrictive notions of recurrence, right? But as we'll show, a lot of mathematicians and a lot of people in dynamical systems have been thinking, like, very, very hard about what other useful notions of recurrence, which are like relaxations of the extremal version of equilibrium. Okay, so you can be recurrent without being in equilibrium. It is not a necessary condition. Okay, and in the rest of this prelude, like, what's my goal is to actually explore what recurrence means formally, not just, you know, from a English definition, but from a mathematical, from a dynamical system definition, and build a whole different set of relaxation upon the notion of equilibrium and Nash equilibrium concept as a result. Okay, so to put that in the language of what we've seen before, okay, look, in game theory we have this different solution concept that we all know and love and understand. Okay, and that's great. Okay, and we say, like, okay, these are all relaxations of standard notions like Nash equilibrium fixed points, right? But now I want to consider and say, like, okay, if you consider the equilibrium, okay, as this stationary point, as this aspect of recurrence, okay, what other notions of recurrence are out there that you can, like, you know, build on top of this? Because let's say you want to say, like, okay, as we know, it doesn't matter what you call it, equilibrium are going to be very, very hard to compute. All right. So because they're going to be very hard to compute, we need to find something that's a relaxation of it. And hopefully this will give us some more opportunities to be able, like, to provide positive computational results. All right. And I'm saying the first step of this sort of, like, relaxed concepts is something that you've all seen in high school, or yes, at least in high school. Okay. And it's the notion of a periodic point, right? So a periodic point is, again, a notion of recurrence. So these things are, like, happening again and again. Okay. And it's actually just a fixed point of f to the k. Okay. So f is your map, right? And equilibrium is just a fixed point that we say, like, okay, I start and I stay here, right? A periodic point is just an equilibrium of f to the period, right? Okay. All right. So all of these, okay, of course, are, like, trivially, I mean, this is something that's already, hopefully, that, you know, we're all familiar with this. Okay. But I also actually want to point something here, which is, I think, I find interesting. Okay. So we know, or at least I know, of very, very little work that asks about, okay, periodic behaviors in games or in economic scenarios. Okay. And I'm saying, like, okay, why not? I don't think it's unnatural to say, like, look, I mean, maybe sometimes we should be looking to find periodic points in some systems. Okay. Maybe equilibrium is not the end all. Okay. And if you find somehow, like, a periodic point with, let's say, low period, this is almost as good as finding a Nash. Okay. So maybe things are not always, you're not at the position we want to be every single day, but you are there, like, you know, once a week. Maybe this is enough for your application. Okay. And maybe this could really be leveraged on mechanism design. Why design a mechanism that, say, that enforces the solution every single point? Okay. If you say, like, look, I want to enforce, you know, maybe like once a week something happens, right? And then the other days, okay, I have some flexibility. And actually, if you really start thinking about this, this is actually necessary if you have a system which is, say, really broad and has to, let's say, meet conflicting requirements. Okay. So let's say, look, you know, I'm some platform and I have, let's say, both, you know, let's say Republicans and Democrats, and I cannot somehow, like, split, you know, what they see, like, based on, like, I have to give, produce only, like, a unified message, right? So then you say, like, okay, maybe odd days, I give something that makes half of my customers happy, and the even days, I make the others happy. Whereas if you try to implement something at equilibrium, at least 50%, let's say, of your market share would be very unhappy and they would move away. Okay. I mean, this is just a toy example, right? But I'm pointing out that, like, this is already, like, once we start thinking from this perspective, like, you can really open up horizons for totally different kind of, like, space of design solutions. Okay. And not just for learning in games, but as I said, even for mechanics design. Okay. Yes?
I couldn't get the URL to work.
No, I tried. Not working.
It's a B and a six.
It's a B.
B, not a six.
Ah, it's a B.
Okay.
See, that's a great B right there. Okay. Thank you, Vasily. All right. Okay. Let's continue. Okay. All right. So all of this, like, a little bit motivation. Now let's see some new ideas. Okay. All right. So here's the new definition. And this is actually one of the most important definition, actually, maybe of the day. This is called the chain recurrence. Okay. And what I call chain recurrence is effectively how a computer scientist would define periodicity. Okay. So here's the thing, is that, like, okay, suppose you have Alice, and Alice wants to check that some specific point, x0, is a periodic point for a function g that she owns. Okay. But here's the thing, is that, like, well, she's a computationally restricted agent, right? So she can only check the accuracy of your computation up to some fixed accuracy epsilon, which may be, you know, let's say the accuracy of your of your data representation, right? Now, here's the thing. Now, there's an Alice. When there's Alice, there's a Bob, okay? So every time Alice computes an iteration, okay, of your function, it says, like, okay, here's my initial condition, give me the next position, okay? Bob, you know, because she has access, let's say, on the on this data, she can actually corrupt the computation by just by a little bit amount, the amount that Alice cannot detect. Okay, so this is below her threshold of detection. Okay, and then this continues, right? So like, okay, so here's the picture. So here's the initial condition. You compute the first map, okay? But the point X1 is not gonna be exactly where you landed. It will be within some ball of radius epsilon, okay? So every time you jump, okay, you allow the system somehow to be perturbed within some small radius, okay? And now if I claim that, like, if Bob can always convince Alice that this position is, that this point is periodic, so that, like, okay, after some iterations, I managed to land exactly where, I mean, within this radius distance of epsilon where I need to be, where I started from, okay? And he can do that, that's the most critical thing, he can do that for any arbitrary epsilon, okay? Not for epsilon 2 to the 10th, 2 to the minus 100, 2 to the minus 1,000, for any level of accuracy, okay? So even for 2 to the minus, like, number of atoms in the universe. So if you can do it for any arbitrary epsilon error correction, then we say that, like, this point is chain recurrent, okay? Does this idea somehow, like, make sense? Okay.
If you can clarify, what does it mean to convince in the last?
Okay, so yes. So the so remember, so Alice is happy if she finds, like, some iteration xi such that this distance is smaller than epsilon. Okay, so if there is some I here in this iteration of points, such that g of xi minus x0 in absolute value is less than epsilon, then she's convinced. Okay.
So are there functions that achieve this with arbitrary small epsilon?
Yes.
It doesn't work with epsilon equals to 0.
Correct. We'll see examples, but yes. Because if, okay, that's a great question. Because initially what you think is about, okay, look, you say for any epsilon, again, as I said, 2 to the minus number of atoms in the universe. This really means that it should buy you nothing, right? But actually it does buy you, okay? So we'll see. So of course, if the epsilon here is zero, if you don't allow for any such leeway, okay? Then this point would be exactly for your point. That would be the definition, okay? But we'll see that there exist systems with a set of chain recurrence points actually a strict superset of the set of the current. Okay. But already you're getting the right message. So because whenever you see something computed by the computer, okay, and it looks like a cycle, you can never tell the difference between if it's truly periodic or if it's this. Okay. So because in any case, your computer always does some sort of, like, errors, right? So maybe the errors are there that adding up to close the cycle, and not exactly somehow like the function itself. Yes?
Like, if I have the identity map, uh-huh, seems like every point is a stationary point.
Yes.
But Bob would be able to slowly perturb it out of the...
Yes.
So it wouldn't be a chain recurrence.
So the chain recurrence is a... So chain recurrence is a characterization of points, again. And as I said, this is a relaxation of periodic points, which is a relaxation of none. So in your system, everything is in equilibrium. So everything is a chain recurrence point, trivially.
But I guess I'm confused about the definition, because Bob can corrupt the computation by epsilon each time.
Uh-huh. Yes, but in this case, Bob does not have to do any sort of, like, corruption to convince.
I see. He's trying to convince her.
Yeah, he's trying to convince her, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. Good question. Yes?
So I guess here it's for Bob and adversarial loops that can happen.
Well,
they're kind of he's trying to convince her that.
Yeah, so you can think of like, okay, maybe, you know, you can, I think you should think of him as adversarial. So in the sense of like, he has a goal, he's trying to convince Alice to be that this is periodic, regardless of whether it's actually periodic or not. Okay. So that is, you know, he has a clear goal, that's his goal. Okay. Yes? Okay, we'll also one more question, then we'll some examples as well.
In physics, you propagate the position of particles, I think you may have said earlier, using like wave mechanics to predict the superposition. Is that
no? In any way, it's interesting, yeah. So we won't go into any sort of like wave functions or stuff like that, but these questions are very relevant for any sort of like physical system. Okay. So, all right. So now I said like, okay, this is chain recurrence. Now I'll give you something that's in between chain recurrence and periodic points. Okay. And now I'm saying that like, okay, look, if Bob can actually get away with using only one jump at the very end, okay. So this is like, okay, true position, true position, true position, true position, true position. And at some point, okay, it gets very close, but not exactly where it needs to be. And he said like, okay, now I'm gonna just nudge it just once. Then this point is called recurrent, okay? And here, because, okay, so the notion of the word chain comes to the fact that you have this chain of like just small perturbations, okay? That's why chain recurrence is defined like this, but this is just called recurrence, okay? All right, so this is somehow the universe of recurrence, ideas or notions. And as I said, like every single such, it's very interesting, right? Every single such somehow concept, although non-trivial and not easy to imagine, right? Like once somebody tells you about this, you say like, okay, look, oh, that's kind of interesting. That's actually is a visible notion of recurrence. And by recurrence here, I mean the dictionary definition of recurrence, right? And what I've so like I've hidden here by these three dots is that there are actually other recurrence notions in between. Okay, I mean, we don't have enough time to go into all of these details, but there are things that are of interest there. Okay, but let's see some examples. Okay, so here's what we've claimed so far, and hopefully, actually you should be 100% convinced for this, right? So all periodic points are equilibria. All periodic points are recurrent, because after all, recurrence points, like Bob just doesn't have to use the flexibility of the last jump, right? So like, and then all chain recurrent points are actually, sorry, all recurrent points are chain recurrent. Okay, so you have this this set of inclusions. And what I want to say is that like, in general, these inclusions can all be strict. Okay, so trivially somehow, okay, everybody understands that you can have systems that have periodic points, which are like not equilibria. Okay, but now here, I'm going to give you a system that has zero periodic points, but whose all points are actually recurrent. Okay, and here's the example. You have a particle, let's say a point mass, that traverses a cycle, and let's say, and at every single time step, okay, it makes a clockwise turn of one radian, so of an irrational angle, right? All right. So now, because the angle here is irrational, like this position is not going to be periodic, right? It will never return exactly where it started. And actually, you can prove that this is actually leads to a dense covering of the circle, and then that's it. If you have like a dense covering, then no matter what the epsilon allowable perturbation is, I always get within epsilon, and then like, choop, Bob will say like, we're done. Okay, so very nice, very simple example of something that is, that shows this extreme difference between the two. Just to give you an example of something that is chain recurrence but not recurrent. So think of something like this, maybe. This is called like a heteroclinic orbit. Okay, so here, and think of this point here. So all of these are fixed points. These are four fixed points, which are like effectively connected via four orbits. Okay, now I'm saying like, okay, imagine this point here, this is your X0. Okay, now this point is not recurrent because, okay, we can only reach effectively up to here. But if I can use epsilon perturbations, right, I can effectively jump through this four isolated equilibria and effectively get all the way back to where I start from. Okay, so here, right, everything is would be chain recurrent in this system. Okay. All right. So, all right. So this is our solution, our set of solution concepts, and one can of course ask a very natural question. I already told you that, like, look, there are actually hidden concepts in between here that actually have a lot of mathematical, legitimate mathematical interest. And every time you saw one of the solutions that I described, one of the recurrence notions, you said, oh, this looks reasonable. I hadn't thought about this, but it's a good idea. Or maybe there's something even above this. Maybe there's something that's even a relaxation of chain recurrence points. Okay. After all, like, we have to start questioning ourselves if we understand the notion of recurrence, right? That is it's a strict superset and still meaningful. Okay. And the answer to this question is no. And now you should also be asking yourself, like, a very non-trivial question. How do you convince yourself or anyone that a point is not, you know, recurrent in some weak sense? Okay. How can you convince of something like, okay, that, like, look, like, this some point, like, really lies outside somehow, like, any meaningful definition of, like, look, I'm going to get back to where I started from. Okay. It seems rather non-trivial once we start, like, building this hierarchy, right? Okay. So a non-trivial solution requires, like, a very deep result. So this result is called the fundamental theorem of dynamical systems. And although you may not be familiar with it, you're familiar with a kind of, like, special version of it. So if we have a system that's gradient or gradient-like, okay, these are exactly like, you know, learning in potential games, for example, right? So these are like systems where there exists a strict Lyapunov function, effectively potential function, that's always that if our current position is not an equilibrium, then this function will strictly decrease. Okay, and this function effectively will force ourselves, the system, to equilibrate at some point. Okay, so that's like we're all familiar with this type of arguments and ideas. That's how we prove, as I said, convergence to in Nash equilibria, both in zero-sum games with optimistic techniques or in potential games, right? You find some potential, some Lyapunov function that captures in some sense the distance to equilibrium, and this converges to zero. Okay, so, but now here's this new idea. Okay, and the new idea says the following: take this recurrence notion of an equilibrium and swap it. Instead of equilibrium, put in our new notion of recurrence, a chain recurrence point. Okay, and now this theorem says that, like, okay, take any continuous dynamical system, either in discrete or continuous time. Okay, so this is not continuous time. Okay, so then it doesn't, like, and effectively take any arbitrary dynamical system. It has such a function that is known as a global Lyapunov function, and this function effectively captures informally the distance to the set of chain recurrence sets. So this thing always will be strictly decreasing up until somehow it reaches the chain recurrence point, okay? And then it becomes level. But the behavior does not necessarily end, okay? It could be that, like, you know, like, on this level set, you just keep running around, right? Okay, but that's it. So you have, so this is how you see, in some sense, like, how you can convince yourself that something is actually not recurrent. It's not recurrent because you have an ever energy level. And this energy say, like, oh, your energy will decrease and it will never get back to where it were. So when you wave that point goodbye, that you're there yesterday, you know that you'll never see it again, because your energy now has become a little bit smaller and it will never reach it. It can never go back again. Okay. So this function is always going downwards or reaches an asymptote. Okay. So it's a very brilliant idea. There's a reason why this. It has such a powerful statement, okay. And yeah, and that's it, it's very beautiful. It says, like, look, like, this is something that, like, feels you can only hope to get it for very special systems. Well, if you somehow like swap what your target to something that's like maybe a reasonable relaxation, then you get it for all systems. Okay. Now the thing, okay, of course, when you have such a powerful theorem and you're a computer scientist, you start asking things about, oh, great, can we compute this function? And the proof actually does not give you any reasonable computational handle on this. Okay, this can be like a very, very complex object. But yeah, so it's a, I'll say it's a semi-constructive result. So yeah, so there's a constructive process for describing this function, but this process is actually not efficient. Okay, so all right, so that's all I'm going to say about the proof. Yeah, and then of course, I mean, in some sense, like, you know, if there was an efficient like constructive method for finding this function, then there's no reason to worry about doing physics or anything. Like, you know, any system will just have total control over it. We would find this function would immediately tell us, okay, look, this is what's going to happen in the future. But of course, there are no shortcuts, right? Systems can be very, very complex. So in all generality, it's rather unlikely that you hope to find such lacunae functions, but like maybe you can find in some systems that we care about. Okay, all right, yes?
There's a question by Kostis. Is the global Lyapunov function effectively counting how many steps to hit the set of chain recurrent points?
The set of steps. At a high level, yes. I'm going to take it. Yes. Okay. So that's definitely somehow like the idea. Okay. So okay. Any other questions? Yes. Whether there's any complexity theory results. Okay, so I can tell you this, that for the, let's say for the case of, let's say applicable dynamics and all reasonable dynamics actually in normal form games, we can find one such point in polynomial time, okay, easily. Okay, what is much less clear is how do you characterize the whole set? Okay, so how do you find actually everything that can happen, right? So yeah, and I can tell you the reason why. Okay, so the reason why in any reasonable game theoretic algorithm, it's in any point along a best response cycle would be chain recurrent, because effectively it's like a periodic point. Okay. But the thing is that like you can have much more complex behaviors over mixed strategies, which are like very hard to predict. We'll show that we can analyze some of them in zero-sum games, but there's a lot of like open questions. Okay. So for example, like yesterday I showed you these really weird attractors, and I tell you, look, normal form games can have this really weird like cycling unpredictably over mixed strategies. Right? And then like this shows the existence of chain recurrent sets that have like very complex geometry, and we have like no handle on them right now. Okay. Yes.
Yes. Can you comment on the connections between chain recurrent and chaos? Like, are not chain recurrent or?
Hopefully, I'm going to get to formal definitions of chaos, but I'm already running a bit behind. Okay. All right. So I want to say that, look, why should we care about this notion? This notion has a bunch of really cool properties. So first of all, this the chain recurrent set, which is the union of all chain recurrent points, again, is an invariant set with respect to the flow. So if you're there, you're going to stay there, which is really great. So it says that like, look, every orbit either belongs fully on the chain recurrent set or it doesn't belong at all. There's not halfway, so like getting in and out. Okay, super nice. Number two, it's closed. It's a closed set. In the usual like topological sense, okay, on the space I'm on the simplex, I have a closed set in the simplex. It's topological invariant. So suppose I have one dynamical system, and I do a one-to-one change of variables to get a new dynamical system, then the mapping of the chain recurrent set to the new chain recurrent set is just just following the same map. So like, okay, that's really nice. Like, you know, this information is being preserved by changing variables. Accumulation just means that, look, it captures all possible limit points of all orbits, okay, which, like, really, it captures all possible futures of the system, which, like, really what we want to predict, okay? Restriction, so we say, like, this general current set is an invariant set, so the flow is well defined on this. So now if you look at the flow only on this set, and you say, like, look, for this flow, what is its own general current set? It's itself. So that's kind of, like, nice. It's like, it's really, it's a very meaningful property. And then the last thing, which is, like, really, really powerful, is the following, is that, okay, these are, like, as I said, this is a closed set, okay? And let's say in the simplex or in product of simplices, and now take its connected components. Now, within each such connected component, take any two points. You can find epsilon orbits from one point to the other for arbitrary small epsilon. So, all right, let me give a picture for this. All right, so I've told you is that, like, look, here's the chain recurrent set, and it has, like, these three different components, okay? And now you're gonna say, like, look, okay, what happens within, okay, I know that I'm gonna end in one of these three things. I cannot maybe predict what will actually happen, but I know I will get there. And now I want to try to get to understand something more about the inherent dynamics. This theorem tells you, like, look, take any two points, X and Y, and you can find, like, this small trajectory is going from X to Y and from Y to X. So everything is connected to everything else. So here it's like a chaotic turbulence where you end up, like, being spending your time depends on the infinitesimal noise of this epsilon noise that perturbs you. Because just using any arbitrary epsilon noise, you can go from any point to any other point. So within such a component, the only things to make some sense to structs is statistics. Okay. So let's say if I'm, you know, given, let's say, some area here, let's say what probability it is that I'll be here. Maybe it's like a 30% probability, something like that. Okay. That's it. Anything else is just, you know, like this. Yeah, it's just affecting totally turbulent. Okay. The behavior. Right? Does that make sense? So, like, in some sense, you might as well think of this component as a single point. So, like, okay, within this thing, anything goes. Okay. So, like, that's it. Okay. All right. All right. Yes. Sorry, I was ready. I'm ready. Okay. So now I said, like, putting everything together, I want to give you, like, a nice mental picture about thinking about any arbitrary dynamical system. All right. And here's the picture. All right. I promised a picture, not a good one. All right. So, all right, these are going to be some mountains. Here's some mountains. Okay. And then here's going to be, let's say, some lakes, which are, like, very turbulent. This is, like, a bunch of eddies and stuff like that, crazy. Okay. And then here's another one. And then here's maybe another one. All right. And so on and so forth. You get the picture? Now you see, like, any dynamical system, you can think of this as a ball rolling downwards across as a terrain. The height is this total Lyapunov function that always goes down, okay? And at some point, okay, either let's say you're gonna, in a special case, maybe you end up at a single point, okay? And that will be converged to equilibrium. But more typically, you end up converging to some sort of, like, very turbulent lake. These lakes are, like, totally flat, because here it's a level set for this Lyapunov function. And within this lake, you're totally moving around like a random particle. Okay. And that's it. Every dynamical system has exactly the structure. So your questions are the following. A, where are the lakes? B, if I am in a position in which lake will I end up finding myself in? And C, what is the statistical behavior within this lake? Okay, that's it. Yes.
Can you ever escape the lake? Like,
no. I mean, okay. So it depends. Okay, let me phrase this more accurately. So as we said, like any such link is a chain of kind component which is invariant. So invariant means if you're there, you're going to stay there for all time. But it could very well be that if you perturbed the way an equilibrium is perturbed, then your height decreases and you escape that level. Except the way somehow in a stable saddle point, if you in a saddle point, if you stay there unperturbed, you stay there for all time. But maybe a small perturbation can move you outwards. Okay. So yeah.
Maybe you can push it to the end of the question. So so here, this assumes the dynamical system is given, but if you start say from the primitive of a game or a strategic interaction, you know, like the dynamical system itself is up to design in some sense, like, you know, what dynamics are people are gonna use to behave in this, and this will then affect what are the your steady states.
That's a great question.
Then how do we, you know, like how do we think of a solution concept if the dynamic is not given to us as a primitive?
Okay, that's great. That's a great question. You can do like a couple of different things. So one of them is to say like, look, I'm going to make some exogenous assumption about some large class of dynamics. And for whatever reasons, I think this is like maybe a reasonable representative assumption about how the agents will behave. I mean, there's always a lot of water in this kind of arguments, but let's say from a theoretical perspective, maybe this is good enough. And I think you could do is something that's like more like econometric style. So I'm actually doing like a bunch of like detailed measurements of how people actually behave in practice. And I've had to create like very tailored behavioral models, okay, about every single agent. And now like you have like a lot of power about working with this thing. Okay. So like you are the one who's gonna work. All right. So okay, and then not so good news. Yes, sorry.
So I just want to follow up on this question. So if I give you a dynamics. Okay. How much can I say about the
Lyapunov? Not a lot. Nothing. So, like, I mean, that's the thing. Okay, so like this as a dynamic, as a you know aspiring dynamicist, like this is the art. The art is like how many, you know, it's like okay, like how do you prove something about a mechanism design proof? Okay, well, there's an art to it. You know, like I have some ideas. You know, I have some prior experience. Like, you know, I know maybe, you know. I pray, like the typical way, the typical way to do any sort of like proof, you know? Yeah, so there's no, but here's one thing that's actually kind of interesting, is that like lately, there's been a lot of like machine learning approaches about automating, like find such things like Lyapunov function. And that, there's a lot of traction there, okay? Like there's even like SOS type of methods. You can even have some probability guarantees. Okay, so like, so maybe not totally pray alone, but like, you know, pray and machine learning. So, okay, so that's it. All right, so yeah, on the not so good news, okay, of course, they're hard to understand. And, in game theory, we really have an understanding of them in relatively constrained settings. One of them is the case of potential games, and then maybe it's not too surprising that the set of CRS and equilibria coincide. But there actually some sort of like technical arguments that I won't go into it. So it's not totally trivial, but that's okay. But I will really focus on understanding this in the case of zero-sum games. And I claim that in games of zero-sum games within Piliouras equilibria, the CRS are everything. Okay, so it's actually very nice. Okay, so it tells you like, okay, look, potential games are one extreme example where in this landscape, there are no legs. Okay, everything goes down to at a single point, at a single equilibrium, not necessarily single, depends on your initialization, but everything ends up at the point. Okay, zero-sum games are just like a huge lake. Okay, like, and then that's it. It's like, it's a flat land. Okay, everything stays there. Now, and you can move around. Okay, so let's try to see that. Okay, I'm getting into like, okay, 10 minutes before break. Okay, all right. So, all right, let's jump into it. I'm just flashing this. We will be mostly talking. We start by talking about for the context of the talk. Just think about these two dynamics. We start with continuous time, the replicator, and then we'll consider discretization. Okay, but yeah, this is our models, and we're going to start by focusing what happens in zero sum games, and that's the thing that we're going to show. So we're going to show this recurrence in continuous time. Okay, so let's try to get that going. And then, what I want to point out is that there's going to be an interesting dichotomy. So this is like Robert Allman, of course, Nobel Prize winning economist, that says here like something that's widely believed, I think, across economics, that like, look, at least to age and zero-sum games, at least this one we've solved, okay? There's a fairly unique, sharp and unique prediction that's like, it's the only reasonable thing that can happen. And I'm gonna say like, look, that may be true maybe from the perspective of economics, but from the perspective of dynamics, the picture would be totally different, okay? So, all right, so here's the high level picture of our results in a single slide. So I would say like multiplicative weight updates and many other dynamics in continuous time, that is like replicator, actually have a lot of formal similarities with conservative systems. Like I think of ideal pendulum, planetary mechanics, and so on and so forth. Okay, so in some sense, there's a notion, there's a specific notion of energy that's being preserved over time. And this energy is this lambda here. And this will imply, will allow us to show that the behavior is oscillatory for all initial conditions. Okay, and the thing about this type of dynamics that are like perfectly like moving around like unpredictable particles is that, as you can think about, now they're extremely sensitive to any kind of discrete, any kind of noise, because any epsilon can go from anywhere to anywhere. Okay, so with discretization, you can do anything. So I will show you how first order discretization somehow is divergent and to where it can actually diverge. How, of course, because this actually talked at the length, so I won't go into the optimistic type of results that actually converge, but I actually show how you can create discretizations that are perfectly recurrent. So you can actually recover a behavior that looks like a simulation of an actual, planetary system just by doing the correct discretization that preserves in some sense an energy. Okay, so that's going to be the ideas. And let's start having some fun. Okay, the reason why we do this work is for this kind of slides. For now, like it's kind of like, okay, let's see some colors. All right, what do we have here? This is rock, paper, scissors, and this is two initializations. Excuse me. One for the row player and one for the column player, right? And these are like, of course, points in the unit simplex and hence the unit square. Okay. And here's what you see. Okay, these are like some random pair of initializations. And as you see here, okay, this somewhat recurrent behavior, maybe not exactly periodic, but something that looks like approximately periodic, like a toroid, which is actually recurrent. Like that's what you already know the story, but here's the interesting thing. Okay, a different initialization, and again, you get a different kind of like toroid behavior, okay? And so now we're gonna prove this. We're gonna prove this 100%. And hopefully I wanna say that like, we can actually understand like the mechanics of the proof. So I wanna hope that like the key ideas are gonna be relatively understood. And if not, please ask questions.
Is this in continuous time?
Sorry? Yes, this is not continuous time, correct, yes. So I mean, that's, as you see, like somehow like the orbits are smooth. Otherwise, it would be like a peppering of isolated points. But yes, thank you. Okay, so all right. So before was a simulation, right? So now I'm going to state a theorem that we're going to try to prove in the next hour or so. And that here's the theorem. Okay, so suppose, as I said, like the game has a fully mixed Nash equilibrium, like is the case of. So fully mixed Nash means that like all sides are played with positive probability, like rock, paper, scissors. Okay. Then, well, first of all, the dynamics do not converge to Nash. And in fact, if you do not start from the equilibrium trivially, you always remain bound away from it. So remember in the picture, like the donut, like never goes close to the equilibrium at the center. Okay. So that's point number one. And that's because the energy at the equilibrium is going to be zero. Your initial energy is going to be positive, so you're always going to be bound away. Okay, so second, this is the we're here for this. Okay, so given any open set of initial conditions, okay, almost all trajectories that start from it return to it infinitely often. Okay, so this is effectively this implies that all but all but a zero measure set of initial conditions are actually recurrent. Okay. And more or less by using closure, you get that that CRS is everything. Okay. So yes. All right. So this is the main theorem. And then there's a little bit of extra technicalities about what happens in the case of in the case where the equilibrium is of partial support. Okay. All right. So if the game is an equilibrium of partial support, then okay, Nash equilibria. Sorry, zero-sum games have a very special property. The set of Nash equilibrium is a convex set. Okay, it's actually a convex polytop. So there's a notion of an equilibrium of maximum support. Like look at the body center. Okay, and that's in some sense the most mixed equilibrium. It has all strategies that are useful for some Nash equilibrium can be found there. Okay. So what the dynamics actually does, it works in two steps. Step number one, I just kill all the superfluous strategies. Okay, the probability will converge to zero. But now I'm gonna find myself in a subgame that has an interior Nash. So I'm gonna cycle. Okay, so all we're gonna see in experiments is effectively the cycling behavior in the correct subgame. Yeah, so that's it. So that's the statement. Okay, so there's a way to actually generalize this to many multiplayer extensions of zero-sum games actually holds not just for all follow the regularity of algorithms, but actually for much more learning dynamics. So here is actually, okay, there's an idea in this paper with Marco Chung that sort of like, that effectively shows that these arguments have some formal connections with this idea of passivity theory in control. I'm just gonna throw it out there. So passivity is a notion that let's say is captured the behavior of batteries. So a battery is a passive operator in the sense of like, okay, look, a battery cannot, you know, it takes as much energy, it stores as much energy as I give it, and maybe a little bit less because some energy is being lost due to like transmission issues, okay? An operator is called lossless passive if it captures its energy exactly. So it's like an idealized object. Okay, these things don't exist in practice. Okay. So in the correct notion of interpretation, follow the regularized leaders can be interpreted as a lossless passive, as this idealized object, okay, that only exists in Ethereum, in ethereal land. Okay. And effectively, the clairvoyance discretization is there to just preserve this lossless property. Because this lossless property is the thing that sort of like implies no regret. Okay. So this is, in some sense, it's a superset of this idea of regret. Okay. That effectively, has this interesting connection with physics. And as I said, these ideas actually can be evolved, can be applied even if the game evolves over time. And as I said, like this answers our questions about the chain of recurrent sets. If almost everything is recurrent, then the closure will take care of the rest. Okay, so that's it. I think this may be a good time for a break. Before we do, are there any questions about the statement of the theorem? I will also leave it up. And if you have any questions, yeah, feel free to come and ask.
Okay.
It's okay.
I was just wondering, like, so given that there's all this chaos and predicting
what happens, does it make sense?
I was wondering if it makes sense to look at when systems where there are many agents and then you predict something about the distribution. Also with atoms, you don't.
Yes, this is perfect. Yeah, this is perfect. That's exactly actually what I'm doing.
You also repeat the question.
Oh yeah, sorry. I was asked by about whether, in the case where we have these chaotic-like systems, whether we should try to predict the distribution of the behavior. Okay, like think of like more like a statistical way of interpreting dynamics. And I told her like, yeah, that's exactly what we do. And I think that's really the frontier of the next step. And I won't talk about this at all, but that's what's coming. So here I'm sort of like, I'm building the foundation for this. So I'm going to tell you where the lake is. Okay. Once you know where the lake is, you're going to use additional information to understand the statistics. But if you don't even know where the lake is, Like there's nothing to be done.
So we're building in that direction.
All right, that's it. Take a break.
Thank you.